My little helper. Hi, everybody. Say hello. Let me know where you're looking in from. Hello, Omar in Chicago. Aloha, Patty in Hawaii. Here are the babies. They have like little homing devices on them, that little baby chick squeak. These are happy chick sounds. They are quite comfortable with the comings and goings in the yard. They're happy to be out of the playpen and free ranging. They come in every night, okay, both nights, by themselves. Hello, Lynn in New Jersey. Hi, Vicky in Indiana. Hello, Connie in Texas and Sue in Minnesota. What's up, Kristen in Wallingford? Hello, Misty in Wisconsin. Hi, Zia in Trinidad. Heather in Canada. It is like ideal weather here. Maybe just a little humid, but nice and cool today. Oh, good, Trisha. I'm glad you like the honey. I think I'm almost sold out of batch number two. Hello, Sherry in West Virginia. Yes, Sable, it's completely normal for pullets to lay eggs that are smaller than their full size because they need to break in the equipment. Hi, Christina. So I'm in full on, okay, she did her hair to clean the coops. Isn't that nice? Maybe she's born with it. Maybe it's Maybelline. Oh, poor Sophia. You should have done it earlier in the morning. You wouldn't have to be on Facebook Live. Let that be a lesson to you. So I'm in full on pinching Japanese beetles mode. I want you to see my... These roses are about to explode back here. We have, this is the Crown Princess Marguerite. Look at the buds on this thing. We're about to have a show here. And I'm going to just pitch a tent out here to kill Japanese beetles every 5 minutes. Because they've gotten to my Graham Thomas. Look, that's no bueno. Uh-oh, sorry, the Wi-Fi cut out. Yeah, you can get kicked off Facebook for that, Renata. We can't offer to exchange live animals on Facebook. That is actually community standards, a violation of community standards. You can't buy, sell, or trade live animals on Facebook. Who knew? Now you do. Yeah, she's cute, all right. I know, Christina. Let's go see the wildflower garden. Christina lives in town. She could just swing by and take a visit, but let's give the nickel tour. I don't know how far we'll get over here. The Wi-Fi is acting a little funny already. But we have the mammoth volunteer sunflower that I did not plant. That's the volunteer part of it. And the Japanese beetles are trying to kill it, but I won't let them. I have my soapy water stationed everywhere. I had a theory. I did have a theory about trying to kill the Japanese beetles because they say that when you have Japanese beetle traps, they have a sex lure in them and a floral lure in them. And in order to look at this is my collection. Ha ha! Oh, Christina, I need to give you that vase back. That belongs to her. It's doing an important job now. They say that you need to empty your bag of Japanese beetles periodically so that the smell of death does not offend the beetles you're trying to trap. However, and I guess they give off an ammonia smell as they die, and that offends them, repels them. So then they say your traps won't work. So I figure if that's true, then hey, let's put some ammonia around the roses to offend, repel. Sorry, my daughter's calling me on my cell phone. Maybe that will repel the Japanese beetles. And I'm the first person to ever think of that, right? I don't know, but it didn't work. I did it and it didn't work. So I put these little jars of Windex vases all around the joint and even sprayed like the wood. It didn't work. It should have worked. What's probably not true is that the ammonia doesn't offend them. That's probably what's true. So we extracted more honey, and the bees are enjoying cleaning out the honey bucket from last night. I just bottled those guys up. I'll be shipping them out a little later. And the beetle traps just attract more beetles. Correct. That's why you have to strategically locate them in the yard, Tim. And I have them in my front yard, upwind or downwind. You're supposed to place them upwind. I don't know how, like, what are you supposed to just keep an eye on the wind and move them? I don't have time for that. But yes, they will attract beetles, but they, you're supposed to put them where you want the beetles to go to intercept them from going to your desirable plants. So I don't really know if it's working. But we've got milky spore in the yard for the past 2 years now, so I'm waiting for that to inoculate the entire yard. I don't know if it works. Who's to say? So, but the Japanese beetles have gotten into my river birch trees, and I'm pretty mad about that. So again, I have another jar of, oh, see, right there right now. Another jar of soapy water, but sometimes I just squish them. Oh, I got them right here. Gross. So much gross. Bye, Felicia. So that's what we have to do if we want our plants to remain relatively hole free. So yeah, that's what's going on. Whole lot of Japanese beetle chasing, because I don't have enough to do with my day. And and the hydrangeas are happening. You guys want to check the hydrangeas with me? The littles are enjoying this part of the yard for the most part, but so the hydrangea leaves provide nice shade for the chickens, which explains why some of the canes are kind of knocked down, knocked over. And I don't mind that so much. It's for a good cause. Hello, Robert. Don't call me chicken lady. I hate that. I really do. Mandy wants to know, why do you not give bugs to the chickens? My chickens aren't interested. I have 11 billion bees, and there's no shortage of dead bees that they could eat. They're not interested. They're just not interested. They don't benefit from them from it in any way. They have a nutritionally complete chicken feed that contains all the nutrients they need in the right amounts. They're not interested. They're well fed. They're nourished. If they find bugs on their own, that's fine. But ain't nobody got time to hand feed chickens insects. That's right. She ain't no lady, says Tim. All right. So this is bad behavior. We need to take this playpen down. Yeah. That just makes it difficult to clean in here. But I guess build roosts. That's the take-home message here. Build more roosts in your chicken coop. They're messing up my artwork. Yeah. That's right. They just like fresh eggs. Hello, John in Pennsylvania. All the men folk are here today. I love that. Love to see the men folk. Say hello if you're lurking out there. Hang on. We have a, I don't know, F-16 flyover or something. Two of them. Cool. You have a hen crowing on occasion? That happens. Wow, they're really loud, aren't they? Woo! Okay, trying to have a Facebook Live here. It's all the same to the federal government. Pipe down. Hello, Helen in New Jersey. Let's go see if we can find, the littles were hanging out around the butterfly bush a little bit earlier, but I don't know where they went now. Oh, I guess they're all in the coop now. Hello to you, Elaine, in Eastern Washington. Yes, Petey would only pick bugs out of the air. That was her jam. Yeah, she wasn't so much about going to all the trouble of finding them in the grass. If they flew near her face, chomp. Boop, 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 boop. Hello, German in Georgia. German? Oh, I'm not a morning person, Peggy. No, I'm not getting up to pinch beetles. Sorry. Nope. Hello, George. Sometimes the hydrangea stems will take root. Yes, I know that, George. I had one. One of the canes was bent over last year, so I actually put, I weighted it down with a rock, and it started to take, but the chickens dug it up this year, so it's all right. Propagating hydrangeas. You never know what else you're going to find here. Oh, let's see. Susan from West Virginia heading to Boston to her son's wedding. Are you really? I think you're going to have to quarantine for 2 weeks. I think Massachusetts is with Connecticut on that. Good for your son. Hello, Barbara in California. Yes, okay, we're done talking about beetles. Let's see what else. You guys wanna talk about chickens? We'll talk about chickens. I'm just scrolling down as I stand here. Here we go. Van from Colorado. What's going on, Van? Van McGraybeard McGee. Very Irish. You know, look Irish. Are you Irish? Colorado? Hello, Wayne in Texas. Hello, Cass, wherever you may be. Valerie in scenic Bristol, Connecticut. Barbara in British Columbia. Your son from Brisbane. Okay, hello, Cass's son in Brisbane, Australia. You got it. See, shouting him out. Is he like 14 or something embarrassing? Lucas? Okay, you got it. Hello, Lucas in Brisbane, Australia. Lorraine in Maine. So not too much going on around here otherwise. What could you do about a chicken picking at another chicken, asks Amador. Well, it depends why that's happening. Chicken picking is a management problem. So it has to do with something you need to try to fix, something you need to change. So I need a lot more information about the circumstances surrounding the picking, like when it started and what sort of things could be stressing those birds. Stress can come from things like an improper diet caused by too many treats. It can be caused by a lack of space, introducing new birds to an existing flock, losing birds from a flock, all kinds of things. Stress, high heat, not so much. They're not going to do picking. John says, how can you tell if a hen is done laying? Well, how old is she, John? Hens can continue egg laying their entire lives, living 8-10 years. Not usually more, but they can continue laying their entire lives, but it will never be at the same rate as it was the first 2 years. I hear George, I just don't see him. So, you can inspect her vent for to know whether she's in lay right now, but that will not tell you whether she will continue to remain unproductive. So, you're okay, short answer, you can't. Sherry said, will I be doing more soap making videos or cutting of the soap? Mr. Chicka Chick is in the house cutting soap right now. Soap making and cutting, all that stuff is really a winter sport here. I have a lot of things to do out in the chicken yard. So, there's a lot more stuff going on in the backyard, including taking care of my 14 beehives and all of the flowers. I don't have a gardener or someone to tend my bees. So, like, I do it all myself. So, the soap is something that I do in the wee hours of the morning or late at night by myself. And it goes a lot faster if I'm not videoing it. So, I really need more hours in the day, but soaping is more of a winter sharing experience when I'm trying to hide out from cold temperatures. I didn't say I had it rough, Jan, Lynn, whoever said that. Jan, Lynn, Jan. I didn't say I had it rough. I just said that I have a lot to do. Yeah. Yeah, my job is My job is behind the camera, in front of the camera at times, always behind the computer. When do I actually sleep? That's a good question, Tim. Not often enough. Any help keeping a fox away, says Tori. Nah, it's a tough one, Tori. You're not going to be able to keep the fox away, okay? Trap it. There will be another one where, you know, to follow. I mean, the best you can do is to be realistic about your expectations with respect to free-ranging chickens, and to put as many barriers in between your chickens and what wants to get to them as you can. We have a 5-foot fence with 3 lines of electric fencing, netting, roping, whatever, electrified ropes. but however, that's not going to stop all predators that want to get into the yard. I mean, really, we did that for bears, for the beehives more than the chickens, because if a critter wants to get into the yard, it doesn't matter how high your fence is, they're going to get into the yard. So you have to know what your risk tolerance is for potential loss to predators if you're going to free range. So it just happens from time to time. And foxes are the worst. Weasels are the worst, but yeah, it's tough. I mean, every predator proofing. Ooh, what the heck was that? Did you see that fly at me? Did you see that green thing? I don't know what that was. It flew under my armpit though. That was yucky. I don't know what I was talking about. Predators. I was going to say something about predators. Every layer of protection you put in between your birds and what wants to get to them is, you know, another hurdle they will have to overcome in order to get to your birds. So just put as many as you can and hope that they find that, you know, neighbors less protected chickens down the street, maybe. You know, if it's too much trouble, maybe they'll just move on. So we haven't always had this electric fence, and I've only had a problem with a fox once. And owls, Lisa, you have a trouble with owls? Well, that should really only be a nighttime problem. And at night, it shouldn't be a problem at all, because your birds should be untouchable in their coop at night. Raccoons, too. Tim, stop. Don't trap the raccoons, Tim. Leave them alone. They have a role in the ecosystem. But here's the thing about raccoons. You can trap them until the cows come home, and there's always going to be more. There's just going to be somebody, some other raccoon to fill that void in the territory. So trapping them might make you feel better if your birds were victims at some point, but it's really not necessary and it's not helpful. And it creates a false sense of security, like, oh, I got him, like there was only one ever. There's always more predators that want to get at your chickens. So raccoons, owls, all of those kind of nocturnal predators should not be a problem for you if your birds are in a secure, predator-proof coop. And every chicken coop should be secure and predator-proof, because there's no way that they can possibly... They don't stand a chance if something gets into their chicken coop. They have poor night vision and they have, you know, really no defenses. They're sitting ducks. Right, Junior? Let's visit with Junior for a few minutes. What do you say, Junior? What's the 411 little guy? They're in the coop. Okay, so Lisa, you need to predator-proof your coop. Your coop's not predator-proof. So if you go to my website, chickenchick.com, and type in predator-proofing, 11 tips for predator-proofing your chickens, I show you what the essentials are of predator-proofing your coop. And the long and short of predator-proofing is you have to eliminate all possible access points from critters, knowing that raccoons in particular have opposable thumbs and can open simple door latches. So this is a two-step latch, and that's a little trickier. If you put the carabiner in it that's supposed to be in there, then they're not going to be able to defeat that. So they might be able to figure that out, but they're not going to be able to figure out the carabiner. So, but the main predator-proofing measure is hardware cloth, welded wire, secured to every window, every opening, with screws and washers, not staples. Because raccoons are really super strong, and they can from the outside, they can pull screening or even hardware cloth in or push it out with their grubby little paws, and staples are easily defeated. Like, yeah, no staples. That's just for curtains. And so screws and washers, and everywhere that something could enter through your coop needs to be shored up with hardware cloth. And you have to close the pop door at night. You can't leave the pop door open. That's just, might as well put a welcome mat out for the bad guys. So they should never, you should never have to find a chicken that has been attacked inside your coop, because that's something you can absolutely control. The only thing that could possibly get in a properly predator-proof chicken coop is a bear. And, you know, I say control the things that you can and don't worry about the rest. If a bear wants to get into the house, our house, a bear is getting into our house, you know, so it's no different in a chicken coop. But you do the best you can, and then you won't have to worry. You're welcome, Donna, no problem. Owls, that's awful. Hey, they got to eat too, right? That's the thing. So, why are we eating that suddenly? Why is this suddenly even a thing that you girls are noticing? It's been there all summer, spring and summer. Dreaded birds. All right. So, predator-proofing 101. Hi, Terry. Oh, Terry, send Craig over for that honey. I'm not going to ship it to you. You're not going to pay for shipping for honey. Come and get it. Stop it! Stop that! They're picking berries off this tree again. They wait for you guys to get here. Nobody does this when I'm not on Facebook Live. See the berries on this tree? That's what they're picking. Crazy birds. You haven't, Christina? Well, you know, you can't argue the fact that that's darn good exercise. All the fatties are trying. Yeah, go ahead. Burn those calories. It's not super smart. It's going to be hot here tomorrow. You don't want to increase activity levels in the heat. All right, Terry, good. However, this girl is lithe. Go ahead. Ah, that's just good entertainment, kids. Oh, silly birds. Ah, we'll wait. The only thing funnier than that is a chicken running. Do my chickens always sleep in the same coop? Most of the time. Chickens are creatures of habit. So most of the time. There's been a shakeup in the rooster pecking order here. A peaceful, gradual shaking up of the pecking order among the roosters. So George has been the top rooster for the past almost 3 years, and he's always slept in here. Pierre is my Crevcore, who is, shoot, I don't even know how old he is. Zia, how old is Pierre? And Pierre is slowly taking over the top spot in the pecking order. So Pierre slept in here last night, and George slept in there. So they swapped, I'm sure much to George's dismay, but he's just smart. You don't try to fight the younger guys. You just give up the seat peacefully, and then everybody can continue to live here. I think George knows that. He's two. Thank you. Zia says that Pierre is two. Zia knows these things. So yeah, that's totally normal. Totally normal for there to be shifts in the pecking order over time. But if the roosters fight for it, I mean, if George didn't want to give up the spot, then there would be a throwdown and, you know, fight to the death. And we're not trying to have that, right, Georgie? You're smart. They're crazy. You're not getting involved in any of that nonsense, are you? George is like, heck no. It's like NBA tryouts for chickens. The NBA. I need help. What's the question, Amy? Is it okay not to leave the hatch open if the run is secured with hardware cloth and washers and screws? I say no, Amy. That is, for me, that's a big no. You want to put as many layers of safety, as many barriers in between the predators and your chickens at night as you can. So if you would be okay knowing that a predator could possibly get into your chicken run and then get your chickens just by walking in the door as opposed to having to work to get in through that second door, then that's okay for you. But I say it's not for my chickens, not for my peace of mind. So there's no benefit to leaving the pop door open. No benefit to that. Why would you want to? Oh, Kimberly says, what are the, what's on their backs? Oh, look it. She's smarter than the average bear. Those are Chicken Chick branded hen mating saddles, and they are designed to protect the hens' backs from overmating. The hens who have been overmated already are wearing them. And, I design them, and I sell them. It's a brand new product and one that I designed because other hen saddles just don't do the job and or are cheap or whatever. There's some sort of flaws with them. So I had started making my own and then folks wanted them. So I have them manufactured and this is what they look like. And this is the packaging. And you can get them at myfavoritechicken.com. See, that's me. Hello, my hair is not that color. But whatever, that's what they look like, and that's the purpose. And they have double snaps for security so that if one fails, the other one is there and it's not going to fall off the bird. You can also, it also makes it slightly adjustable for smaller, thinner hens. And it's triple layer of fabric, but it's sturdy fabric. It's not that lightweight sort of cotton. It is a duck cloth material, so the rooster's not going to put his toenail through her back through this material as he could with a thin, flimsy cotton saddle really designed for fashion. So it's got a denim type black material on the back, and then on the inside it's reinforced. There is I forget what I call it, interfacing on the inside, and then the way that I have it sewn is so that you can wash and dry these very easily without it shriveling up into a weird wad that will never get back to its original shape. So that is it, the Chicken Chick hen mating saddle. But the most, you know, most important feature of this is that it fits properly. It protects the areas that it's supposed to protect. People think that defeathering on the back of the chicken's back where its tail meets is like the, you know, the most saddles are designed just to protect that area there. But most of the damage from a rooster standing on a hen's back occurs on the wings right there. Boop. And most saddles don't protect that part. So that's why I had to design my own. And so there it is, designed. And you can get it at myfavoritechicken.com. My favorite chicken. Favorite. Whoa, 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 whoa. Okay, so that pecking order thing, not entirely established yet. Who just did this? This wasn't here a minute ago. Who made this mess? It's like running a kindergarten. Take your eyes off them for 2 seconds and they're trashing the joint. another segment of the yard. All right, I want to take a moment to look at this poop, okay? You guys good with that? Okay, let's. So, it's warm today for a chicken. Let's see, I don't know what the high temperatures were. It was in the 80s. Right now, it's about 78 degrees. But if you're a chicken, you have a high core body temperature. Your temperature is between 104 and 107 degrees Fahrenheit. And you're wearing a down jacket in 80, 85 degree temperatures. So they already run hot and are starting to feel the effects of heat stress and working to keep themselves cool when the temperature hits 85 degrees. So one of the ways that they maintain that body temperature and try not to die in the heat is by drinking more water. And in doing that, they move large quantities of water through their digestive tract, which takes heat out of their bodies. So a lot of times people think their birds have diarrhea in the summer because it looks like that. Now, this is a completely normal poop for summertime. Why is it green? Well, that green can actually be a bad sign in chicken poop, except this isn't, because I know that my birds have been eating the grass all morning, or all day. So that is a completely normal poop installment for summertime. If you saw that in wintertime, your bird's probably dying. So that means they haven't been eating at all if they're only passing that green stuff. So that's bad. So important to know. Normal poop in high heat looks like really wet. So it's called excretory heat transfer. I just like saying excretory. What's the problem, Jenny from the block? I don't think so, Legina. They're not form-fitting. You see, the saddle is really just literally sitting on top of her, like sitting on top. It's not form-fitting. But when your hens need a hen saddle, you need to put a hen saddle on them. It doesn't matter. They need to wear it. It's for safety. It's not like an optional fashion accessory. It's needed. Who did this? Who was up in here? You? You're at the scene of the crime. You're like an arsonist. I only don't mind because these need to be cut back anyway. But hey, you could pick up after yourselves. That'd be nice. Okay. Here, you can get a good look at the saddle now. See how it's just like lightly sitting on her back? It's not, she can dust bathe with it on, no problem. You need a booty bath, girl. I can arrange for that tonight. It's gonna be Africa hot here the next week. We're looking at a heat wave here in Connecticut. 90, close to 100 degrees, not cool. It was Sophia that did that, Tim. Why would you want to try blaming it on a teenager? Legina, I imagine you're having a side conversation with somebody about picking injuries. If you have a bird that has wounds or injuries from picking, a saddle is not the solution to that. You need to find out what type of stress is causing the picking in your flock and eliminate that stress. So the stress is the problem. Just covering it up with a hen saddle is not a good idea, because the problem is going to continue to exist. And anytime a bird is injured, you need to remove them from the flock to protect them from further injury, additional injuries, and to tend the wound. So I don't usually recommend a hen saddle for birds that are being picked or have injuries. You have to get to the bottom of the problem and Fix it. So I can help you with that, Legina. If you leave me more information about when the abuse started and details about your flock. Did you add new birds to the flock? What are you feeding your flock? Not only what are they eating in terms of their chicken feed, but what are they eating in terms of extras that you're giving them, if any? Have you added new birds? Did you lose any birds? How much room do they have inside the coop? How much room is inside the run? Do they free range? Like, all of those things matter, and I will be able to help you to narrow down what needs to be fixed. But picking is a management problem. So it's some sort of situation that has been created that we need to fix when they're picking. It's not normal. It's an abnormal behavior based on stress. So we need to eliminate the stress. Right, Duke? Right. Let's see. What does this say? I didn't mean to do that. Sorry, I just blocked you accidentally, David. I was trying to read a question. I didn't mean to. I'll go back and fix it later, but I can't unblock you in the middle of... Sorry about that. Ooh, that's what it's like to be banished to the dark side accidentally. Oh, sorry. Let's see. Okay. Jennifer says they bought chicks from a local farm store and they were sexed, but several of them have turned out to be roosters. They're 3 months old. What should we do? Asked Jennifer. So that is normal, Jennifer, and to be expected. Each chick that is sexed has a 10% chance of having been sexed incorrectly, which is 90% accuracy in any job is pretty good. Unless, of course, you're a brain surgeon or a rocket scientist, in which case maybe not so much. But 90% accuracy for vent sexers is really good. It's a difficult determination to determine whether a male or a female, whether a chick is a male or female, right after hatch. So, what can you do about it? Well, you're going to need to find that if you can't keep roosters, you're going to need to find them a new home or somebody who will process them for meat when they are old enough. And I know that as backyard chickeneers who keep pet chickens, that is not a that's not a viable solution for many, but it is a valid use of a bird that cannot be kept given what the alternatives are. So if you can find a large farm in your area who might benefit from having an additional rooster, then contact them and see if they will. I mean, There aren't too many options beside rehoming them and giving them to somebody to use as table meat. Oh, hello. Oh, good, George. I'm glad you like the spruce the coop. You know what? Let's check for eggs. I haven't checked this afternoon. I did check earlier. Let's put this away. And oops. Oh, whoops. Oh, whoa. I almost just dumped the entire live feed accidentally. All right, let's see if we have any eggs. Nothing. There's one. There's two. Is there an egg eaten in there, or is that a... No. So these are plastic nesting pads for whoever's typing that question right now. These are plastic nest pads and plastic bottoms, although the plastic bottoms I'll often just use cut up empty feed bags. And I use these instead of something else because they stay in place. They protect the eggs from breakage, from accidental breakage, because a hen stands and squats a little bit when she lays an egg. So that protects the egg from hitting the wood of the nest box floor, and it facilitates cleanup. So those are the two primary purposes of nesting material. and other types of materials that I've used do not meet both of those requirements, so that's why I use them. And they wash up really easily. They're reusable, sanitizable. Oh, and this plant has gotten too large to live here much longer. All right, what do we have here? An egg eater? Did you eat it? You ate her egg. I see that. That's when I talk about cleanup, that's what I'm talking about. Not only eggs that have been intentionally eaten by cannibals, but eggs that have accidentally broken, or chicken poop, which is common. Get out of there. There. Now it's not of interest, is it? You have yolk on your waddle. I mean comb. All right, I'll clean that up later. Get out. All right. So there was an egg in there. I just need to be faster than the hens next time. All right, let me go put this in the cleaning bucket and check the third coop. Who is that? Heidi, we're dealing with egg eaters. All right. Pow, the hired help will clean that later. Oh wait, I am the hired help. Shoot, lousy system. All right. Take our two eggs and mosey on over to the chicken chick essential coop, which can be in your backyard, in barn red or in PD teal. As well. Available at chickenchick.com in the shop tab. But go in your heart, you're welcome. Alrighty then. Oh, I just talked about that, Lisa. Go to my website, chickenchick.com, and type in why nesting material matters. And I show you all about what they are, talk about why I use them, and links to where you can get them. All right, nothing in here. This is the rollout nest box that works the best. It's just a simple painting tray. But sometimes they manage to defeat that system too. So that's it. Two eggs for the afternoon. Mrs. Kravitz is following me. Dude, you have yolk on your comb. I'm not sympathetic to your situation. Bye, Felicia. All right, the red coleus. I know, aren't they gorgeous? The red coleus are fabulous. They need to get cut back a little bit. I mean, a lot, actually. But there's only so many hours in a day, you guys. Only so many hours in a day to do all the things I need to do and kill Japanese beetles with my raw hands. Yes, bare hands. Kelly wants to know, how do you feed chickens at different ages? I assume you mean who live together. Can you feed younger chicks a layena? Absolutely not, Kelly, because layer feed has calcium in it that can damage the kidneys of your chickens who are not yet at the point of lay. So never feed layer feed to chicks that are eating, that are less than 18 weeks old, unless they're already egg laying. They don't need all that calcium. Their bodies can't do anything with it, so they have to excrete it through their kidneys, so that can give them kidney damage, so don't do it. So you can feed both of them. I kind of want to know more about your flock, like how old the chickens are, to be more specific about how to feed them. But if you go to my website, kellychickenchick.com, and type in feeding chickens at different ages, that's the title of the article where I talk about options. So, yes, Lisa, I have. Mm-hmm. Well, sometimes coleus isn't just a filler. Sometimes coleus is just the feature. Yeah. For example, ta-da. Yeah, sometimes the coleus is the star of the show, Tim. Yeah. Doesn't have to be a backup singer. It's its own feature. That one has really exploded in the past week. And that was just like an extra one that I had no place to put. So I stuck in a pot that doesn't really go with the whole aesthetic back here. But How about that? It's spectacular against that miscanthus grass, isn't it? Yes. I know. Tim with the filler. All right, let me put these eggs right there. Is that going to fall through? It will fall through. So where else can I put them that the chickens won't get them? I'll put them on my gazania. There. All right. Kimberly in San Diego, how are you? Okay, Kelly says her two groups of chickens are 18 weeks old and 14 weeks old. I would give everybody Purina Flock Raiser with a side dish of oyster shell. That's what I would do. Yep, Purina Flock Raiser. So they're almost fully grown. And the side dish of oyster shell is essential for the 18-week-olds. They need to start building up their calcium reserves if they're not already laying eggs. So yeah, they need that calcium to start storing. They will store calcium in certain hollow bones that they have that are designed for that purpose, and they will mobilize it when they do need it. What is going on in here? Was there a party in here, George? I'm scrolling down here. Hang on. Oh, thanks, Heidi. Oh yes, hostas do not stand a chance, Heidi. Let me just tell you, I've been trying for years to make a hosta happen in my yard, but the only way, the littles fit back there. They can fit through this fence, by the way, as evidenced by Henny Penny back there. The sky is now falling. Trying to show Heidi the hostas. Don't dig anything up while I do. These are the hostas that I got when they were on clearance last year. And here's the weird thing. I don't know what it is about hostas and chickens, but they eat them like potato chips, and there's nothing you can do about it. Meanwhile, these sedum, almost untouched. They might dig these up. We saw one of the hens starting to do that this week for the first time. But not eaten, not torn off, not ingested. So whatever, it's the same color as hostas. So green is fine with me, and that will be all green by next year. But you don't belong in there, so you're gonna need to get to stepping, sister friend. All right, so I will offer her an out, and she will go right through that fence. Watch, that's how she got in. Ugh. Hang on. I'm trying to, hey, this way. Nope, not that way. That would be that way. I was saying this way. Here. Yoo-hoo. I just opened the door for you here. All right, I'm going to have to go over the fence myself. That's right. Doo, doo, doo. Think like a chicken, you guys. You see the out? Bang a hard left right there. Nope, you missed it. There you go. There it is. Fly like... You could have done that without the door. Okay. Just saying. No one said they were actually intelligent. I mean, they're not unintelligent, but... not real problem solvers, these chickens. So here's the littles. These are the Whiting True Greens. That is the Blue Lace Red Wyandotte. He's a cockerel, which bums me out. What can you do? Where's Heidi? Heidi, here's another example of hostas. Look at all these other plants back here. We have some more of the sedum. We have some clethra. We have some bee balm that came along for the ride when I transplanted these from a different part in the yard. But, oh, what's that? A hosta. Oh, no, it used to be. What's that? A hosta. They used to be. And then all these other plants that they're not at all interested. So I don't know what it is about hostas, But I think they hate them. I think they must kill them intentionally because it is like a salad. The girls who are on diets. It's a salad. I'm just going to have a salad. I'm going to pass on the insects. Not so much with the scratch. We'll just go with the salad. I just said that you don't touch these, and then you did. Just like kids, make a liar out of you. So that is what's going on around here, you guys. A lot of misbehaving chickens. They're prepping for the chicken pageant. That's right. They're sucking weight for the 2020 Miss Hen America pageant. If you guys have never seen or considered Fayumis, these are spectacularly beautiful birds, and they change so much. They have like three different color patterns, it seems. When you get them as chicks, they're brown, and by the time they're fully grown, which is about another, what are you doing? Oh, she's auditioning for the America's Best Weather Vane competition. Yeah, why should the roosters have all the glory? I agree. That's a good view. They're gorgeous when they're adults. They're like kind of like a silver, but they're pretty flighty, so they sometimes don't stick around. The first Fayumis that I had disappeared, so hopefully these guys stick around. And they didn't get picked off by a predator. That's pretty apparent when it happens. So a lot of times they'll just fly over the fence and then that's it. Well, I suppose predators involved at that point. But Egyptian Fayumis, they're just stunning. They're just not, they'll never be lap chickens. Whoops. What did I do? Did I ban someone else? I did not. I don't even know how you managed to get up there. That was quite a feat. Yeah, you're a little perplexed about the whole getting down process now, aren't you? Yeah, it's P.S. Your wings work. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Whoa. First step's a doozy. And this one, please don't poop there. It is white. That's not a roost. Are there picture frames hanging in there? Yes, those are picture frames. Please don't poop on there. Please don't poop on there. Boop, get down. Go on. Do they lay eggs like other breeds? Yes, yes, all chickens lay eggs, provided they're of age. Which breed is the sweetest in your flock? I love the Bielefelders. I think they are the friendliest of the breeds I've ever had. This is a Bielefelder. It's a new breed to me this year. I got them at McMurray Hatchery. And they're gorgeous and pretty curious. Pretty curious, pretty friendly. Not at all skittish. Whoops. This is Jennifer Bielefelder right here. Let's see if I can get her to take something out of my hand. I have this feeder here that I need to fill up. Let's see if I can get something, remnants out of it, and get her to come over here. Oh, it's a lot of, not much. Come here, Jenny. Jennifer. Okay, George, where are you? He's pretty friendly, too. So you guys, chickens are very trainable. This is not, it's in part rocks and in part Purina flock raiser. Here. Chickens are very trainable, so you don't have to come at them with treats in order for them to befriend you, in order for them to be happy, in order for them to love you. Their chicken feed is all they need, and they are healthier if that's all they eat than if they eat other things that you find fun to give them. It's all the same to them. It really doesn't matter. Except to their health. And do you see how they're picking around the pebbles, the rocks, the stones, whatever? Chickens eat with their eyes. They're very visual, and so they will always pick out the biggest, brightest particles first and eat those first. All right, let's get some other food. Oh, look at you eating out of the grandpa's feeder. That's not authorized at your age. What warmer do I use on my baby chicks? I use a Brincy Eco Glow. So this is just flock raiser, you guys. It's just their chicken feed. Just their nutritionally complete chicken feed. Nothing else. But I've drawn a crowd. Because as far as they know, hand feeding is a treat. Right? All right, this way. Let's go find some grass that isn't pooped on. All right, this looks like a clean spot. There you go, George. You and me, kid. He's telling them that I have treats. So smart, George. How do you get nice roosters? It has nothing to do with me at all, Julie. It's just genetics. It really is just genetics. It's luck of the draw. You don't want to choose a game bird that has been bred for fighting. Historically, but if they turn out to be aggressive, human aggressive, that just relates to their genetics, and there's nothing you can do about that. You can't make a rooster be mean, aggressive, and you can't stop them from being aggressive. That is just how they're hardwired. No, we don't kiss chickens, Sue. Hashtag salmonella. How about some for the girls? George is a black copper Morans, Anne. Where's Libby? How's she missing out on this? I bet she's roosting already. That face. So Marie says then it's okay for children to feed them, ? I don't know what you're drawing that conclusion from. I would be careful with children. Just because chickens like things that are shiny, and children's eyes are pretty close to the chicken's beaks. So just be on the lookout, supervise, and I mean, be careful. Ow, that's my thumb. Because while they don't have teeth, those beaks sure are pointy and strong. So yeah, just always supervise children with chickens. For obvious reasons, safety reasons, and to make sure that the kids aren't doing something that's gonna get them sick later. Wash your hands afterwards. Don't wear the same shoes in the house that you wore in the chicken yard. That kind of thing. I don't know, that's just mesmerizing, isn't it? Look how accurate they are with their beaks. Yeah, roosters are chickens, Marie. Roosters are a male chicken. Hens are a female chicken. Yep. What is on their wings and why? So those are Chicken Chick branded hen mating saddles, and they protect the hen's back from damage that could be done during mating when a rooster stands on a hen's back. That's how they mate. So George is growing those feathers back, and someone keeps picking them out. The problem is it's been defeathered for... Come here. Can we see? Come here. Over here. Here. He's got pin feathers all around his neck, but I think when they see that, they're pulling them out on the roost at night. Here you go, Cleo. This is a good therapy. Ow! Ow! It was good therapy for a minute. It really hurts. I don't even have shiny nail polish on. Not so much with the therapy anymore. Here you go, bud. Look how precise they are with their beaks. So when we talk about chickens, people like to say, oh, my chickens love watermelon. They love mealworms. You have to really know that when we say that they love a particular food, they are not loving the flavor. They're not appreciating the flavors of foods in the way that we think they are. Ow!
Oh, that hurt!
All right, no more for you. Move along. Here. Chickens, if you watch George, when they pick up their feed, they do it at a rapid speed. He's like using chopsticks. He can only get one piece of crumbles at a time, most of the time, into his mouth. Then the crumble is ushered to the back of his throat with his tongue. And so it really whizzes right past their taste buds without being appreciated. And chickens only have about 250 taste buds compared to our 9,000 taste buds. So the way that we taste flavors is to chew our food and mix it with saliva in our mouths. And then while it's sitting next to our taste buds is when we're appreciating the flavor. So since chickens don't have teeth, they're not chewing their food, and it is going right past those very limited taste buds into the back of their throats, down into their crops. So they're really not enjoying flavors. So when we say they love a particular treat, it doesn't mean that they love the flavor of it. They may be, you may have trained them accidentally, unintentionally, or otherwise to behave in a certain way when you come out into the yard with a bag of treats or with a bowl of watermelon or however you deliver your treats. Your chickens have come to know that means you're about to offer them something ingestible. And they don't love it because it's tasty. They just have become trained to behave that way. In the same way, my chickens have come to be trained to behave this way with chicken feed. This is just a nutritionally complete chicken feed. And it's actually what's best for them to eat. And there's nothing wrong with her comb, Melissa. That's how her comb is supposed to look. Chickens have different comb styles, and most people are just accustomed to the single comb. Both of these birds here have single combs. Hers is a single comb that is large because of her breed and flops over. That's normal. This hen has a pea comb, which is, she's a hybrid, so it is normal for her to have a comb that is the pea. This girl is the pea style. This girl is a buttercup. That's the name of her breed and the type of comb that she has. And it's a really cool comb style. And if I can get her over here, she's not super trusting of me ever. But there are approximately 9 different comb types in chickens. Oh, hang on. I'm going to scroll back. What did I miss? All right, guys. Well, that is my time for the evening, so I'm going to jet, but I will check in with you a little bit later on. I will answer questions that I may have missed while I'm wrapping soaps later. And I appreciate you visiting for a while here. I invite you to use my website, chickenchick.com, as a reference for all chickening questions you may have. And if you can't find an answer, I'm happy to help you get to one. Running chicken. And of course, you can always get accurate, reliable, fact-checked information in my book and blog. My book is The Chicken Chick's Guide to Backyard Chickens, Simple Steps for Healthy, Happy Hens. And until next time, keep it simple, and we'll talk soon. Hey, can someone peck the finish icon over here so that I can go in and eat? Anyone? Anyone? Bueller? All right, I'm just going to put this right here then. Don't tear up the grass. Bye, guys.